In this video, I'll be covering the second chapter from my book, Fourier Analysis and Spectral Estimation. Okay, in the first chapter, I covered how trigonometric functions such as sines and cosines can be used to represent arbitrary periodic signals, and this is called basically Fourier analysis. In this particular chapter, the second chapter, we discuss how complex exponentials are used in lieu of the trigonometric functions, that is, sines and cosines, to describe the Fourier series equations and what the consequences of using complex exponentials is on the spectrum. So we'll be looking at the Euler's equation, what it means for a complex exponential, what the projections of the complex exponential are. In this particular section, we'll see the development of a double-sided spectrum, which is the consequences of using a complex exponential to describe the fundamental harmonics. So that's about what we're going to cover in this particular chapter. So let's go to the chapter. And so the purpose here will be to look at complex representation of the continuous time periodic signals, exactly the same as what we did in the previous chapter where we used trigonometric functions. This is Leonard Euler. He was one of the foremost scientists of his day. He was born in Switzerland, but spent majority of his productive years in Russia, in St. Petersburg University. He actually was one of the first to introduce the concept of log x, e to the x. He standardized the use of e, the function e, the I, the term I, and pi, and these became as of 17 or late 1700s, the standard and common language of mathematics. He was a very, very productive man and really one of the men of modern mathematics. So one of his accomplishments was that he described a new function called the complex exponential, and he described it in this fashion: e to the j omega t is equal to cosine function plus a sine function. However, there's this little j stuck in there, and we'll see what that j stands for. This is an equation that's goes by the moniker of Euler's equation, and it has been described as a very enigmatic, beautiful, and all sorts of superlatives, and it is indeed an amazing looking equation, because here you've got cosines and sines, and here you've got a strange looking exponential on the other side. And not only that, it's very confusingly, what's this j term doing in here? We know j is a square root of minus 1, but what has that got to do with sines and cosines? And in a moment, we'll see how that all plays out. So this particular term right here, e to the j omega t, is what we call the complex exponential. So subsequently, you'll be seeing my use of the term CE. And when I'm talking about CE, I'm talking about complex exponential, which is exactly the same as this term here. And this is our Euler's equation of the complex exponential. Before we continue with the idea of complex exponential, just briefly going to go over some concepts in complex numbers. So the complex number idea starts with basically numbers that lie on a plane. So here's, you have a, let's say we start with the number 3, and if we are to multiply it by minus 1, what happens to it? It lands over here. So, which is essentially, it does a 180 degree shift. It goes from here to there, jumps from here to there, but it's still lying on the same line, and let's just, for the heck of it, call it real, the real line. So what minus one is construed as is a 180 degree shift. We can do that. If you were to multiply this number once again by minus one, what happens? It also does another 180 degree shift, and it becomes from minus three to plus three. In other words, if you multiply a number by minus one squared, it does 180 degree shift, and then does another 180 degree shift, and becomes three again, or it does a 380 degree shift. So minus one squared is equivalent to 380 degree shift of a number. So what if a number is over here? What does that mean? Okay, this is where the letter J comes in, or I. Well, actually, the reason why we use J in lieu of I in electrical engineering, and that's pretty much only in electrical engineering, as far as I know, where we use J for this operator instead of I, is because the letter I can be confused with the nomenclature that's used for the current, the I. So we use J, but it's the same as I, and that's used in mathematics and many other fields. Okay, so what happens if we want to shift a number by 90 degrees? So if you multiply this by minus 1 to do 180 degrees, we multiply this number by square root of minus 1, or we multiply it by something called J. So that puts this number over here on a axis, which we call imaginary. And they're really quite, you can think of them similar to the idea of the Cartesian coordinates, and this would be the x-axis, this would be the y-axis, but with complex numbers, instead of calling it x and y, we call it by the more general term of real and imaginary. These also are sometimes called I and Q term, the I or in-phase term, and Q, the quadrature term, which is quadrature means it's 90 degrees phase shift from this number. So multiplication by J is seen hence as a 90 degree phase shift. So what does division by J mean? Well, division by J is same as multiplying by minus J, because you can see here x divided by J times J over J is JX. This is minus one, becomes minus one. So we get minus JX. So if you multiply a number by minus J, it's the same as multiplying it. I'm sorry. Dividing a number by J is same as multiplying it by minus J. Hope I didn't confuse you there for a second. Okay, now let's go back to our complex exponential. So this here is our positive complex exponential. It has the exponent plus to the J. There's equivalent complex exponential called the negative complex exponential, and that just has the negative. And the difference between this one and that one, as you can see, other than this minus, is that this term, the summation in between is now negative. So by putting a minus sign here, what happens is that this sine term takes on the minus sign. Now, frequency hasn't become negative, it's just this sign in between these two terms is negative. And this is called the negative complex exponential. Now, how can we visualize this function? Well, it's fairly easy. We imagine any number, any complex representation which has this J term in it, can be plotted as a three-dimensional function. We're going to give omega a particular value, and then we'll compute three values for each specific omega. T is a variable. For each t, we would get a cosine value and a sine value. So we have three values for each time we have a sine value and a cosine value. So it's really no different than any other three-dimensional figure, and we can plot this using MATLAB. And in my book, I have the code. You can look it up. And this is what it's going to look like. T time goes this way, the cosine value goes this way, sine values goes that way, and what you end up is a helix. So this complex exponential is a helix. Now, if you were to put a negative here and plot the same thing, We see we get the same helix of the given omega frequency, except the direction is opposite to the other one. Whereas this term is negative and this term is positive. Positive exponential is sine cosine omega t plus j sine omega t, whereas negative exponential is complex exponential is cosine omega t minus j sine omega t. So they look the same, directions are different. That's the only thing. Now, here, what we're doing is we took the same figure, same exponential, but MATLAB allows us to plot the projections of this helix. And we see that for the positive exponential, the projection is indeed a cosine wave. Positive cosine waves, one value starts at one and then goes on. And in the imaginary plane, we'll call this real plane and the imaginary plane, they're 90 degrees to each other. We get the positive sine wave. As you can start, so zero goes up, goes down. So same thing for the negative exponential. We see that again, same as this one, we are getting a positive cosine as the our projection, but in the imaginary plane, we're getting the negative sine projection. You can see that this one goes up, this one goes down. So what's the difference between these two? Is the frequency negative? No. Only thing is that the amplitude of the sine has become negative. And this is some MATLAB code in my book, which allow you to pass to plot all these figures. Now, so interesting thing to note is that for the positive CE, the real part, now what we call the real part is the one that doesn't have the J in front of it, is cosine. And the imaginary part is the second part with the J in front of it is the sine. Both of these are positive. For the negative CE, the real part is cosine omega T, it's positive, but the imaginary part is negative. And we'll see what the effect of this fact is. Now, we can do some interesting mathematics. We can take the positive exponential and the negative exponential and divide by half. And amazingly enough, these two sine terms cancel, and what we get is cosine. So this still tells us that cosine term is can be the cosine wave, in fact, can be created by adding two exponentials, a positive and a negative, and dividing by half. So this is equivalent. You can say it's a definition, or you can think of it as a representation of cosine in terms of complex exponentials. And we can actually go ahead and plot these two exponentials, and we see indeed when we plot it using the same equation that I gave you earlier in MATLAB, that we would get a cosine. So these two terms added together give us a cosine. Whereas if we were to plot this term, the difference between the positive exponential and the negative exponential divided by 1/2 j, what we get is the cosine wave. Now you're probably saying, what is this j doing here, and what is that? How do I plot that? Well, j doesn't really come into the calculation as much as it tells you where to plot this thing. And whereas cosine is plotted in the real plane, the sine, because of this J here, is plotted in the imaginary plane. It's imaginary is just a term, and it doesn't mean that it's any less real than cosine. It's just a way that we distinguished in the phase difference between these functions. And similarly, we see that if you were to add these, divide by 2, and use the Euler's equation, like this term here would be cosine plus j sine omega t divided by 1/2, and then this term would be cosine minus, which minus becomes a plus. So these two terms cancel, and what we get is the expression of sine omega t. All right, so now the question comes, why is this equation so important? Before we continue, let me digress just a little bit, and that is say that when we first come across sine waves in maybe ninth grade in our first trigonometry class, they're sort of given to us, sort of like as if they're some fundamental function, maybe divinely given as an inspiration. We have no idea where they came from. We're given an equation, we're told x or some function is equal to sine of something, and we accept that, and until we come to a class such as this one, when we realize that actually even sine waves, sines and cosine waves, are composed of other, even more fundamental functions, and that fundamental function is a something called an exponential. And this comes to us from Taylor series expansion. And if you look at what Taylor series tells us, is that, for example, a cosine wave, for example, is the 1 plus square root of the term divided by factorial 2, and so on and so forth, all even terms. And the sine of x is x, and then all these alternating sine terms. You can actually see it, and you can actually see sine wave being formed by addition of these. Here's the first term, sine of x. Then we subtract from it the second term, which is down here. Then the third term, which is the x to the fifth power divided by 5 factorial. And then once again, the negative term. And if you keep doing that endlessly, what we get is a sine wave. So that's pretty amazing. It's a bunch of real exponentials added together can give us both a sine and a cosine wave. And how accurate that is just depends on how many terms we add. So if it goes on to infinity and limit, that's we get the sine and the cosine. Now, the exponential e to the x, which is related to the complex exponential, except it's not complex, it's real. X is some number real, and is by Taylor expansion is given by this term. And you can see the similarity between this one and this. The exponential has all terms, 2, 3, 4, 5, doesn't have odds or even, whereas cosine had even terms and sine had odd terms plus change of sign, etc. Whereas the exponential itself has all these terms. And we're going to see how this is actually can be broken out so that we can express e to the x as a summation of sines and cosines. So let's do it this way. Let's take x and set it to j theta. Okay? And the term theta, we'll just use the term theta, even though we also know that this is equal to omega t, because in signal processing we're interested in time. We like things like omega t. We don't like angles. So, but we're going to leave that for later. Right now, just to make things simple, I'm going to take this equation and convert x into j theta. And when we do that, we recognize that we'll get a lot of powers of j. So j squared, whenever it's squared, it becomes minus 1. J to the 4th is minus 1 squared, so it becomes 1. J to the 6th is minus 1 again, because it's a 1 times minus 1, etc. So now what we do is we substitute those values into this equation, which is really this equation, except x has been converted to j theta. So now note that some of these terms I've colored in red, and there's a reason for that, because I'm going to split these terms out. And what I'm going to do is put this term here, then this term here, and then this term here, and then that term here, and then this goes here, and that goes there, etc. Then we see that this expression, one part, is exactly the same as the Taylor a series expansion of cosine. It's exactly the same. And the sine, here's the sine, and you see that splitting e to the x in two part, e to the j theta in two part, the second part is j times the other equation. The other one did not have a j, but this one has a j because, well, that's how we set it up. So what that tells us, that e to the j theta is sum of cosine plus j times sine. So in fact, what we've just done is we've proved the Euler's equation. So it's not arbitrary. It's based on algebra, based on Taylor series. And now you hopefully understand that it is not just a definition, but it is indeed a mathematical truth. Now we can do some interesting things with this equation. Let's set theta to pi over 2 and see if we can make some sense out of it. So e to the j pi over 2, cosine of pi over 2 is 0 because it's 90 degrees. Sine of pi over 2 is 1, so we get j. So this tells us that this number is equal to just plain j. Now if we were to set theta to 3 pi over 2, we do something similar. This number comes out 0, this one is a minus 1, and this term is equal to minus j. And another interesting result is if you set this to pi, theta to pi, cosine pi or j of sine pi is negative 1. And from this, we bring the negative 1 to the other side, we get e to the j pi plus 1 is equal to 0. This is kind of an enigmatic equation. It's got an e and it's got a j and a pi and a 1 and a 0. It's just amazing looking equation, but it all comes out of the Euler's expression for the complex exponential. Now in Fourier series analysis in chapter 1, we used sines and cosines, and what we did is we computed the coefficients of these sines and cosines, which is what we call the Fourier analysis. So the question is, why are we switching to complex exponentials? Sines and cosines sure do look easier than complex exponential, but it turns out that trig functions are easy to understand, but they're hard to manipulate. For example, if you had to cube a cosine, it's or higher powers, it gets very difficult to manage. And adding and subtracting and multiplying, etc., the all simple stuff is really not all that simple. And exponentials, on the other hand, are considerably easier to manipulate. So this is the main reason why we use exponentials and, in fact, complex exponentials in Fourier analysis, because it makes the math easier. Okay, so recall that we expressed a Fourier representation of a signal as summation of particular harmonics. So this is omega zero, which we call the fundamental, and then two times the that, and then three times, and in fact all the way to k times or to infinity. Now when we use complex exponential, we'll do the same thing, except we don't have two terms, we just have one. And the other thing we're going to do, and I'll explain a little bit later why, is that we're going to, instead of k going from 0 to infinity, the k, the harmonic index, will actually go from minus infinity to plus infinity. So for example, we'll have, here is a complex exponential. Now remember, this represents both sines and cosines of k minus 3, k minus 2, and then minus 1, and then 0, and then 1 and a 2. So two terms are now combined into one term. All right, so this is how the trigonometric Fourier series looks. And now, and the coefficients, in fact, the a0 and the coefficients for the cosines and coefficients for the sine were given simply by integrals of the given f of t times successive multiplication by each of the harmonics, starting with the fundamental and then higher frequency harmonics. And we compute these three coefficients in this fashion. And it's fairly easy as long as our we don't have a lot of terms, and this integration can be computed easily. So, but now what we're going to do is we're going to replace the sine and the cosine terms by the complex equivalent definition. And remember, we said that cosine was equal to 1/2 of the positive exponential plus the negative exponential. So in this particular equation right here, I've replaced cosine omega t with this term, except for the ak. Ak is still there. And then the sine term, same thing, is this time is the minus the 2 exponential and divided by not just 2 but 2j. Now we can rearrange this stuff. We can pull the positive exponential here, and we get the a. So what we get is this term times this positive exponential, and then this term times the negative exponential. So now we can simplify it a little bit more. We take this term right here, this term, and we give it a new name, which is ak. And then we take this whole term and we give it a new name of bk. And then we rewrite the whole thing as a0 is still there. We haven't done anything with it because we're going from index of 1 to infinity. Ak times the positive exponential and bk times the negative complex exponential. And we do the same thing with the coefficient, the trigonometric coefficient. These are the equations that we derived in chapter 1. And here, instead of cosine and sine, we're going to replace it with the complex exponential equivalent. So here's what I've done for the ak and bk. This is the cosine term, and this is the sine term. And remember, it has a j on the bottom for the sine. So actually, we can expand this a little bit, and ak becomes this from this part plus this part, which is from the negative complex exponential. And same thing with bk. We split it into two parts, and these are the two parts that we get. So we can see that the trigonometric coefficient is split into two parts. One half for the positive complex exponential and another one for the negative complex exponential. We'll talk about this a little bit later on, that how trigonometric coefficients split into two, with half going to positive complex exponential and half going to the negative. We can now define a new term like this, whereas ak is just the coefficient attributed to the negative exponential and b to the positive exponential. So ak and bk can be thought of as the coefficients of the positive and the negative exponentials, and they're analogous to the trigonometric coefficients ak and bk. They're similar but not the same. Now we can rewrite this Fourier series equation like this. And what we're going to do is the same thing that we did for trigonometric. We're going to allow k to go from 0 to infinity, and this takes the 0th coefficient as part of the range of this equation. Now we can simplify this even further by extending the range of k from minus infinity to plus infinity. But what does that buy us? Well, what it buys us is that we no longer need the negative exponential. This alone, by allowing the k to go from minus to plus, it takes care of the negative exponential. So the equation's becomes even simpler. So we can rewrite the Fourier series equation like this with using only the positive exponential and a new coefficient called ck. And this, so now we only have one coefficient instead of three that we had for trigonometric Fourier series, and we only have one complex exponential, and that's the positive. This particular complex coefficient is given by this equation, and it's fairly easy to calculate if you go through the math in my book. And ck we find, recall that because k, the index goes from minus infinity to plus infinity, so if k is greater than zero or is on the positive side, is equal to this. And if k is on the negative side, then this coefficient is related to the trigonometric coefficients like this. So basically what's happening is half of it is going to the positive side and half is going to the negative side, as we will see. Okay, now the question is that we ask is, because I said that the index k now is both positive and negative, sometimes this causes confusion. And the confusion is that we tend to think that because of the plotting convention, which is the frequency, we start to think, did the negative cause the frequency to become negative? Well, not really, because all we've done is we have changed the index to negative. The frequency has not changed itself. In fact, if you look at this complex exponential, it's equal to cosine and sine. The negative one has a negative here, but at no point is the frequency actually become negative. And the reason why this confusion occurs is because of the way we plot things, and that is that the when a spectrum is plotted, what we plot on the axis is k omega zero. And because k goes from minus infinity to plus infinity, this term can be positive or negative. So it's the index that's negative and not the frequency. So oftentimes, because of the way spectrums are plotted and they're labeled, the x-axis is labeled as frequency, we start to think that somehow the frequency has become negative. But at no point is the frequency ever negative. Frequency is always a positive quantity, and the confusion is what actually we are plotting when we plot a spectrum. So this gives rise to what we call a double-sided spectrum. It spans from values of k, which go from minus infinity to plus infinity. And we're plotting this k value times omega zero on the x-axis. So calling this term frequency is intuitively comfortable, but then we have to worry what this negative frequency means. And by negative frequency, what we've done is really we've unknowingly converted a complex idea into confusion for ourselves, and so we need to keep in mind that what we're plotting is index time frequency and not just the frequency alone. Now the complex coefficient values that we compute are actually one half of what we calculate in trigonometric domain, and the reason is because we represent one the index k is used to represent a sine and a cosine. So half of it goes to the sine and half goes to the cosine. And the way we plot it, it turns out that what we are plotting is the composite sum of the two, and hence, or basically the magnitude. So half of it goes to the positive side, or the k positive, and the other half goes to the negative side. So the reason why the amplitude values are split in half can be explained intuitively. We let the index go from minus negative to plus negative, and each frequency is now multiplied by both a positive k and a negative k. In reality, each frequency has only a certain amount of energy. So So really the two have to work out. The trigonometric, since it's completely equivalent to the complex, and hence the each of the indexes, the plus and the minus, get half the energy, and we'll see when we plot these spectrums. Okay, so very very simple case of computing the complex coefficient of a very very simple fundamental signal. It's just a real cosine signal. Now we can represent the cosine signal as a as this equation, which is 1/2 positive exponential and plus 1/2 of the negative exponential. It's very easy. Now it's really very very simple. I mean, if we were to plot the or compute the trigonometric coefficients, we see that the value is just a located at omega 0. But for complex exponentials, we needed a k equal to 1 to represent the cosine, and we needed a k of minus 1 to represent the sine. So the two values get split, and instead of getting a, what we get is a over 2, and we get 1 at the positive value of k equals to 1. So we have k omega 0, and then we have minus k omega 0 for the other half. So we get a over 2 here, a over 2 here, and we represent this as our frequency line. And this is the real axis, and this is the imaginary axis. But since this is a cosine, we plot it in the real plane. Now let's do the same thing for sine omega 0 t. When we represent sine complex exponential, I recall that has a j on the in the denominator, so that's what you say here. Now when we plot this, so again we have two exponentials. Here's one for k equals to 1, and the other one is for k equals to minus 1. Has the same magnitude, a over 2, but we'll see. But there's this j, so what do we do with this j? Well, nothing really, except that we don't plot it on this other axis. We plot it on the along the imaginary axis. We don't plot it along the real axis, but imaginary. It's still a over 2, but recall that this is plus for 1 and minus for minus 1. So we plot plus for this one and minus for that one. Or could have been the other way around. Whereas the one-sided spectrum for a sine wave is exactly the same as it is for a cosine wave. It has an amplitude of a, and it happens only at k equals to 1, because trigonometric coefficients don't have negative values. They give rise only to a one-sided spectrum. But when we are dealing with complex exponential, we get double-sided spectrums in this fashion, because the reason is that the k has a sign. All right, now let's do another example. We're going to take now cosine and sine omega t. Now recall that when we did the cosine, we had a component, let's say of a in the real direction, and for sine we got a certain magnitude in the imaginary plane. So when we compute the magnitude, we just RRS these, and so this is the number that we get when we have two. And the way we show that is we take cosine and we create this expression for the cosine, which is the plus summation of a complex exponential plus another one. And then sine here is a negative, there's a negative sign here, and then there's a j here. So now what we have now is at each k, we have two terms, and to plot it, we need to RSS them together. So the spectrum for the summation of this is again a real function. So cosine omega t plus sine omega t, this is a real function. And when we plot it, what we get is these two, we get this RSS value, and we can plot it like this. Again, this axis is k omega 0, and at 1 k omega 0, we get this value, and at negative, we get that value. And if you were to look at the one-sided spectrum from the trigonometric coefficients, we would have gotten square root of a, because cosine is 1, sine is 1, and the RSS of that is square root of 2a, and here we just get half of that. So this is from the complex exponential representation, this is from the trigonometric representation. So now we're going to do something interesting. This particular spectrum is for simple sine cosine added together. But now look at what happens if we want to compute the complex exponential representation of cosine omega t plus j sine omega t. So this is now a complex function. This is a real function, this is a complex function. Again, we can do the same thing. We represent the cosine here this way, and sine this way. This is a j in the numerator, and there's a j in the denominator, which cancels out. And so what happens is that the net result is that we only get one term. A lot of these terms cancel out. And the spectrum then becomes one-sided. And the reason why that happens is because for the cosine we get two one in the positive side and one in the negative side, both positive. And for sine we get one in the imaginary plane and one going the other imaginary plane, but we're dividing by j. And if you recall that when we divide something by j, we rotate it, and then what happens is that the component that was imaginary, it rotated down and canceled the cosine component, and all we get is the term in the positive domain. So complex signals, just by the way the mathematics works out, give us one-sided spectrums. So only real signals have symmetric spectrums about the origin. The complex signals often do not. They give us one-sided spectrum. So the spectrum for this complex function, because of this J here, is actually one-sided. This is a complex magnitude, and it's strictly a one-sided function. Okay, what about this function? It's just a constant. So we can represent that at frequency of 0. And this is term 1, this is also 1, and we get 8. So basically the spectrum is very much similar to the trigonometric representation, and we get a amplitude of A, or 1, at the 0 frequency. And here are some additional examples. Here, cosine squared omega t, and this would be, well, it wouldn't be all that hard in trigonometric form, but it's easier to do it. And with complex exponential, it's equal to that, and we square it, and we get this. And now we see that these are our equivalent to our fundamentals. So we have one at 2 omega and another one at minus 2 omega, and the amplitudes are half and half. And 1 at 0. So we get 1 at in the middle, and we get 1 half at the plus 2 value, and another 1 half at minus 2 omega 0 value. So this is the spectrum of this particular real function. And as we see, because it's real, we get a symmetric spectrum. So here's another real function, 2 cosine omega t times cosine 2 omega t. And again, it's fairly easy. You represent this by one complex exponential at frequency omega, and then this one at another one, and at 3 omega. So when we do the plot the spectrum, we get 1 half for at 1 omega, which is this, and then this one is for the negative k equals minus 1, so that 1 half goes here. Then we have 3 omega, or k is 3, then we come here, and that gives us this 1 half. And this is minus 3, we go here, and this 1 half goes here. So this is the spectrum of this particular equation. Similarly, we can do the same thing with any arbitrary sines and cosines, whether they have complex or real. This is real function again. And its spectrum is going to be symmetrical, and as we see through this calculation, that this particular spectrum does indeed come out to be symmetrical. There's a few more examples there in my book. And actually, let's go back and take a look at this particular function. This function here is complex. This is real, but this is not. This is these two terms are have a j in them, so this qualifies this as a complex function. So what I said is that the spectrum of this signal will not be symmetrical. And as we see when we compute this, that indeed the spectrum is not symmetrical. And here what I've done is I've computed the power spectrum. And basically you do that by squaring each of these numbers and then computing their 10 log or in dBs, 10 times 10 log of the number. And then I've normalized it for this value. And then, so this would be the this would be what we would call the power spectrum. And this is a power spectrum derived using complex exponential. So now this is where you see that oftentimes when you see the spectrum, you don't see these, you don't see it written in terms of K omega. What you get is just frequency. They've done the multiplication and they've given you frequency. So when you see these numbers, you see negative frequencies here, and you, it makes you think that somehow the frequency has become negative. But I'm telling you that the frequency has not become negative. Only thing is that you're overlooking the fact that what we're multiplying is k times the frequency, not the frequency by itself. So I now we're going to come to a very important example, which is a periodic signal of square pulses. This is such an important signal that in my particular book, every chapter, as I introduce new concept, we look at how the signal, how the spectrum of this signal is, it comes out under various different circumstances. So here we have a signal, it has a period of t, and the pulse lasts a time tau. And we are going to compute, we use the equation of complex coefficients, and from this particular equation, this is the expression for it. We only need to go from tau, minus tau to plus tau, because it's zero after that. And this is our one period. So the function is one during that period times the complex exponential gives us the coefficient. Now I can multiply this out, integrate, blah blah blah, you do this, you do that, and you come up with the complex coefficient equals to what I've done here is I've introduced a term called R, which is duty cycle, and duty cycle is really tau over t. In other words, how long does this pulse last relative to the period? We'll call that the duty cycle. And so if tau over t is small, that means the pulse is narrow. If tau over t is large, then the pulse is wide. And of course, if it's one, then it's just a straight line. So if you look at the complex coefficients of this function, they use a function called sinc, which is this ratio is defined as a sinc function. And actually we can look at some plots of this pulse for various duty cycles, and they look like this. So as duty cycle, or the tau over t ratio, if it's small, then we see that the spectrum or the frequency response is shallow. And as this number starts to get large, the spectrum gets more and more peaked, which sort of makes sense because the spectrum of a flat line would be just a single pulse at the origin. So as you can see that this function is approaching that single impulse at the origin. Now, this particular function is very, very important in signal processing. You should have really very good understanding of what a sinc function is And you should be able to just rattle off from the top of your head what happened as the to the spectrum as the duty cycle of a square pulse changes. Now, I've been using the word frequency response in some of my discussions, and I'd just like you to know that frequency response term is just another name for spectrum. It's the ideas are quite similar. So in this chapter, I covered the complex form of the Fourier series, and this is a prelude to our next chapter, which is the Fourier transform. So both of these chapters 1 and 2 discussed series, not the Fourier transform. We'll see how transform is quite a different idea than Fourier series. And we see that in both of these representations, that even though the time domain function, such as cosines, sines, and functions that I've been showing you, have been all continuous and periodic, the Fourier series coefficients themselves are discrete. In other words, the spectrum always has these impulses. So in this chapter, we covered Euler's equation, we covered continuous time complex exponential, which is e to the j omega t, complex coefficients of the Fourier series as opposed to the trigonometric coefficients, and we discussed the double-sided spectrum. Now, you can read these in my book, the summary, as well as at the end of each chapter, I've gone and given some questions that you can ask yourself. They're designed to really test your conceptual understanding. They should not actually even require a lot of written mathematics. You should be able to answer most of these questions in your head. So do take a look at them and try to answer them. And if you're able to answer all of these, then that means you understand this topic completely and well. Thank you, and bye.